In the 1850s, the largest newspaper in America, the New York Herald, covered a women's rights convention seeking access to the ballot. The newspaper wrote, and I'm reading it here, "This is a women's wrongs convention, which consisted of a gathering of unsexed women, all of them publicly propounding the doctrine that they should be allowed to step out of the appropriate sphere to the neglect of those duties which both human and divine law have assigned them. Is the world to be depopulated?" Pretty hard to hear to our modern ears, isn't it? Just listening to a few sentences of that editorial was enough to make us bristle. We hear it and we think, what were they thinking? Of course, it's easy for us to see the obvious injustice of denying more than half the population the fundamental right of voting. What's more difficult than seeing the shortcomings of our ancestors, though, is asking ourselves that tougher question. Which of our own practices might future generations be shocked to learn about? What might our descendants 50 or 100 years from now think about some of our beliefs and conduct today? Now, there's no shortage of issues that seem ripe for such self-reflection, but there is one issue in particular that I suspect makes for an obvious candidate, and that is, what might our descendants think about how we treated some of the most vulnerable and powerless in our society? And by that, I mean, what might they think about how we treated animals? No, the point is not to equate one injustice with another, but rather simply to ask ourselves where our own ethical blind spots may be. And when it comes to our track record on animals, I'm not so sure that our descendants are going to take that generous of a view. But first, let's just ask ourselves where our species has been on this topic, because for most of humanity's history, we largely confined our consideration perhaps to our family or our tribe or maybe later to our nation. But in recent centuries, social reformers have struggled hard to expand that circle of moral concern out beyond just our tribe or our nation to start including the interests of those who maybe aren't of the same race or nationality or religion or sexual orientation, to the point where today, most Americans would say that, even if not in practice, in principle, we believe that all human beings deserve our respect and our consideration. Our mere membership in humanity alone justifies our inclusion within that circle of moral concern. But in recent years, many public thinkers, both on the left and on the right, have been asking, must we continue expanding that circle further out? To include, yes, of course, the interests of those of our own species, but also to start thinking about the interests of anyone who can suffer, regardless of how many legs they have or whether their skin is covered in fur or in feathers. It seems pretty hard for us to think like that, doesn't it? But keep in mind, what was common sense to our ancestors, like that New York Herald editorial opposing women's suffrage, doesn't state common sense for that long. Just think about it. Less than 200 years ago in our country, we were having a debate over whether one human being ought to be able to own another human being. Respectable members of society, doctors, teachers, members of Congress could be found on either side of the debate. After all, slavery had been the norm in human civilization for millennia. Long before Abraham Lincoln assumed the presidency, the Egyptians, the Greeks, the Romans, they all had slaves. Today, thankfully, nearly all of us accept that slavery is a moral abomination. Yet a blink of an eye ago, historically speaking, that was not the mainstream view. Just 100 years ago, our country was debating whether the children of the poor ought to be forced to labor in factories and coal mines, with even the Supreme Court regularly striking down child labor laws as unconstitutional. Just 50 years ago, our nation was having a raucous debate over what? Whether blacks and whites simply ought to be able to share the same water fountain? Something hardly fathomable to those of us today who didn't live through the vicious Jim Crow era. The list goes on, and it begs the uncomfortable question, which is that if our society is to continue expanding that circle of moral concern out further, and we do start taking the interests of animals into our ethical calculations, just how might our practices today appear to the people of tomorrow? What will they think, for example, when they learn about the factory farms that produced virtually all of the meat and eggs in our era, when billions upon billions of animals were languishing inside of these dark warehouses that really more resembled gulags than farms? I suspect they may not be that impressed when they learn about the cages that these factory farms sentenced animals to live in, often barely larger than their own bodies, preventing them even from turning around or extending their limbs for their whole lives. Imagine telling our grandchildren that these factory farms produced chickens who not only never saw a ray of sunshine in their lives, but also were genetically manipulated to grow so big, so fast, that many of them had difficulty even taking more than a few pitiful steps before collapsing underneath their own unnatural bulk. Or that the day of their slaughter was the best day of their lives, as was the day that their chronic suffering finally came to an end. Did these animals commit some type of a crime that warranted such perpetual punishment? Of course not. They simply had the misfortune of being born into an era when Homo sapiens thought so little of virtually every other species on the face of the planet that no allegation of a crime was even necessary to justify allowing industries to inflict unending suffering on them. The mere fact alone that they are not human today justifies us excluding them from our circle of moral concern. But our perceptions of other animals are now changing, and with good reason. Where in the past, we often viewed animals as largely mindless machines, today, it's getting harder and harder to ignore the scientists when they tell us that actually, the animals with whom we share this planet have far richer mental and emotional lives than many of us would have ever imagined. Sure, we all know about the chimpanzees and the gorillas who have learned human sign language and can have basic conversations with us. Most of us now know that animals like elephants and orcas have extremely complex social relationships that means that they suffer immensely when we confine them in cramped theme parks or in circuses. But the field of animal cognition has now gone far beyond these so-called charismatic megafauna to start including exploration of the minds of those animals we often hear much less about, those we eat. Just take the chicken as one example. Right now, if somebody calls you a chicken, you probably take it as a diss. In reality, though, the next time somebody calls you a chicken, your best response is simply to say, "Thank you." Because chickens are actually extremely intelligent animals. They have great memories, they plan for the future, they can even perform well on basic math tests. You may be wondering, how well do they do? Well, according to the scientists, chickens outperform human toddlers on basic math tests. No, 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 don't worry, certainly not your little genius, but compared to your neighbor's kid, chickens are little avian Einsteins. The same goes for pigs. Animals who are famously smarter than dogs. Yes, we can teach them their names and to sit on command, but did you know that pigs can play video games? Yes, with joystick in snout, looking at the monitor, controlling what's going on the monitor with their own mouth. And how well do the pigs do? Let's just say that these pigs give the primates a run for their bananas, doing as well as chimpanzees on these video game tests. You all thought that Angry Birds was a popular game? Just wait till you hear about Angry Pigs. As we gain a greater appreciation of just how mentally sophisticated other animals actually are, it gets easier and easier to feel that sense of bewilderment that our descendants may experience when they learn about how animals, like chickens and pigs, were treated in our era. No, I doubt that they'll be calling for animals to vote, though I suspect they may vote more wisely than we sometimes do. But it doesn't seem impossible to me that these future generations are going to view our present-day relationship with animals, one that's largely based on violence and domination, with more than a little skepticism. Just as we sometimes contemplate the social views of our ancestors, and we wonder, what were they thinking? In the history books of this future era, they may have a very difficult time reconciling their new ethical standards with our present-day treatment of animals. They may wonder how anyone could have ever defended the cruel view that simply because these individuals were not born human, that we would deny them virtually any legal protection from cruelty and allow industries to torment them in pretty much any ways they ever want to. At the very end of the 1700s, philosophers Thomas Paine and Mary Wollstonecraft published groundbreaking books seeking to expand their society's circle of moral concern. Paine's book, The Rights of Man, was a passionate plea for protecting commoners who weren't part of the ruling class, while Wollstonecraft's book, A Vindication of the Rights of Women, argued exactly what its title implied. Their advocacy of an expanded circle of moral concern in their day was considered so outrageous that one aristocrat, Thomas Taylor, lampooned both of them, publishing his own parody in 1792, A Vindication of the Rights of Brutes. Taylor argued that, in his satirical rebuke, if we were to take these arguments seriously and expand the circle out beyond just those who are presently in power in their era, meaning essentially wealthy white men like him, the next thing you knew, we would have to start taking the interests of animals into consideration too. Of Paine's and Wollstonecraft's zeal for protecting animals, women, excuse me, of their zeal for protecting commoners and for protecting women, Taylor joked, "We may therefore reasonably hope that this amazing rage for liberty will continually increase and that they will universally join in vindicating the rights of brutes." With the benefit of hindsight, we can now see that in Taylor's jest, there was actually far more truth than he would have ever imagined. What was a laughable joke to him, that we take animals' interests seriously, may simply be considered the uncontroversial common sense to our descendants. In this new era, they may have a very difficult time learning about what we did to animals in our day. But this circle of moral concern in our society, it never expands in a self-executing manner. It happens only because big people stand up for those with little power. And in the case of animals, it will happen when such kind and caring people organize to give a voice to those individuals who presently, both figuratively and literally, have no voice. Our generation can be the one that pushes that circle further outward to start considering the interests of those who currently have no consideration, giving our descendants the luxury of accepting what they will consider obvious to any contemporary in their time, that the animals of this world are not mere commodities who exist simply to serve us. Rather, they are our fellow creatures who deserve a so much kinder society than the one that we have given them so far. There's no better time to start creating that kind of future than today. Thank you.